atau hake hoi sa lai, si mamu hole wana kani tā, si thok ka ki lai nōm sa yo mā le Miami, Oklahoma. Ni kia Kerry Silverhorn, te nōtā Clint Silverhorn, kōkuti Teresa Peacock, te somewhat Lance Silverhorn. So, my name is Talon Silverhorn, and I'm here today to talk a little bit about the diadem that I made for the Cultural Center.
Have you made a diadem like this before?
I have not, so this is my first time making this. I knew all the techniques and things that went into it because they're all present in other traditional decorations and things. It's just this is the largest scale that you see most of these techniques being used. This is kind of the, what you consider like the epitome of a lot of these techniques. This is the first time that I have made one of these, but I'm already planning out my next one.
Can you talk about the different techniques that are used in the creation?
Anyway, so the kind of, I would say the most obvious part of this, the most striking, is probably this deer here. So this this standing sort of comb around the outside on the top, this is all deer tail, white-tailed deer. It's been dyed red. I dyed all the stuff that goes along with this. So this is dyed with cleaver root. This is one of our most vibrant traditional reds. Even though this came out a little bit rusty colored, I dyed it in a brass kettle, and I think that changed it, because most of the time when you dye with cleaver, it comes out looking like that red, you know. And so this came out a little bit more on the orange side, but I like it. And then the black, the quills that are black, are dyed with a mixture of black walnut and iron dust, and then these red are also dyed with cleaver as well. But there are a couple of techniques, one of which you can't really see because it's covered up by the band, but this roached hair, you know, it's basically tied in a sort of linear fashion. So on a loom, I take and run a strand, and then off of the tail, you clip about just little pinches of hair. And you take those pinches of hair and you fold them over the top of that, and you tie each of those individual bundles to that loom to make, you know, whatever you're going to do. Usually it's on roaches that go on the back of the hair, these little small fan roaches, you know, but this is maybe like 8 roaches worth of deer hair in this one diadem. The other big thing is, of course, the quill work that goes around the band. So this is what's known as plaited quill work, you know, it's the same, it's another loom technique where you take a loom and you run 2 strands, and these 2 strands you weave back and forth the porcupine quills to create your pattern, you know. And so these strips, we traditionally use them for straps on bags or on neck knife sheaths. You'll see them used as decorations, you know, for hanging deer tail cones and other things. But this, again, this is some of the longest, separate of like a strap for a neck knife, this is some of the most comprehensive, you know, versions of this technique that you're going to find in these diadems. And then here on the front, you've got a woodpecker scalp with the beak attached, and some hawk breast feathers standing up in the front. And so, and then decorating the top edge, you can see on the top here to finish that raw leather edge, there's another form of quill work, what's known as edge quilling or edge work, and where, you know, you take a separate cord of leather, and you sew the quills to the front, and then you fold them around and do that over and over and over again. And so quill work is, you know, one of our most traditional and long-standing adornments on things, holatwa kithana, you know, or pipes and things like that. Quill work in particular is kind of one of the things that if you see items like this, especially, you know, these more traditional things, quill work is usually what you're going to find on it. But this diadem is a very unique sort of piece for me in that, you know, this is not something that I make often. I do quill work, but an item like this in particular, this is a special thing for me because it's not something you see a lot of people use or have today or know about today. So most people are familiar with gustoys, the way that those work for Six Nations folks, but Shawnee people have our own sort of versions of this, in a sense, you know, as well as Wyandottes and other people up in the Ohio Valley, Lenape folks. But these diadems are sort of the precedent or predecessors and the sort of brothers to those gustaways. So this particular diadem is meant for an Inato, a warrior, or specifically a war captain, right? And so an elected war chief would have a diadem like this, because this woodpecker is also a warrior, and so is the hawk. These are two of our Nanato birds. They're warrior birds. These symbols, the things that go into it, are all reminiscent of that status. That's kind of one of the cool things about this particular thing, is that there are diadems that are meant for people who speak, you know, people who go out and talk to folks, you know, Hokima. That's one of the things that I think is cool about it for me personally, is being able to make this and know exactly what it's for, you know.
You said that this is the first one that you've ever made. How did you kind of figure out how to make it?
So, like I said, I knew all of the techniques that go into it. It's just upscaling all of that, you know. And so, looking at original diadems, so having seen several originals of different makes, so you'll see diadems that have the leather bands like this. You'll see diadems that have like fawn skin bands, so green fawn skin bands, or birch bark, you know, or rawhide bands. Some of them have wrapped quill work, you know, strips. Some of them have actual, you know, like lane stitch or other embroidered quill techniques on top of them. But a lot of them have this sort of deer hair comb. There are lots of versions of them, and a lot of existing ones in museums and places around the country and overseas. And so a lot of the construction techniques are very similar, you know, even if they're not identical to this particular diadem. A lot of them are made in a similar sort of way. Looking at those old diadems, looking at pictures or in person, if that's an option, is always the best thing. And kind of seeing exactly how they're put together, you know, and getting good pictures of those things and figuring out where they come from and what time. I basically use that to construct this as kind of a historic average of what we see in these original items.
Do you know any more about like when a war chief would have worn their diadem?
So these diadems, you can think about a lot of these things, a lot of the, especially the nicer clothes that go along with people like that. They're almost a little bit like a military uniform, like your dress blues, right? So these diadems, or you know, particularly like neck knives and other things like that, they have very specific purposes. And so you know, these elected war chiefs in Kimawiskape, in council, or in going out to meet with other people, you know, these are symbols of their office. So just like people that wear a flag lapel pin, you know, and things like that, these diadems are symbols. You know, you have peace chiefs and war chiefs, your elder women, your head women, as basically the functions of your community, you know. So you've got these motherly voices that are kind of running the show, that authority flows from them, and then Mayawin Kitinamachin, the left and the right hands that actually do the work of the community. Those war chiefs and those peace chiefs are the sort of seat, those Hokima. They're like the voice, the external voice of the community. And so when they go and talk to other nations, when they go and meet in council with people, their symbols, you know, the things that are unique to them are worn at that time. And so out on the battlefield, probably not going to be wearing something like this. But any official capacity, any time that they're there for a purpose, for a business, you know, any time that they would wear their gorgets and wear their fine shirts, this is when they would have these types of things on. I brought these along to kind of show, you know, the different forms of quill work. So these porcupine quills, that's what these are. So this is not beadwork. A lot of folks kind of mistake this for beadwork, but this is not beadwork. You know, glass beads and those techniques that go along with them. A lot of the techniques that make up beadwork are very similar to the techniques that make up quill work, wrapping and embroidering on different things. So this is a pipe meant for lathama, for tobacco. But it's carved out of greenstone, out of steatite, and it's got a viburnum stem. But the stem here is wrapped in porcupine quills. And you can see the seam here on the bottom side. Again, you know, that cleaver red, that black walnut black. The white is the natural color, and then like golden seal yellow. This is a very dark golden seal because I dyed it after I dyed the red quills. This pipe, and then like, you know, jimaholath wa kithanut, these makaw kithanut, these moccasins, they also have quill work. And this is what a lot of our traditional moccasins look like, these right here. And so previous to coming to Oklahoma and having our clothing and other items influenced from other tribes, you see those kind of vamps that go over the seams and tops and things like that, or these really long puckers that go all the way up the top of the moccasins. These are our oldest style of hula atua kithanut. And so this porcupine quill work that runs down the seam here, that runs down the toe and the heel, you can see here on the flaps, I've got some quill work, and then you can see the difference here. That's a glass bead right there in each of these little planting heels. So I've got tobacco, and I've got corn on these moccasins. But quill edging, you know, everything that's on here besides the seeds in these mounds is quills. And so, and they're walnut dyed brain tan leather. I've worn them for several years now, so they look a little funky. These are our moccasins, and you can see that technique, that zigzag stitch that makes up these rows. And then this is a lane stitch. It's what that's called, a lane stitch. And that's what you can make fine designs with, or, you know, embroider specific outlines for things. Between this quill work and hair embroidery, moose hair and caribou hair embroidery, that's what decorates most of our traditional items prior to the introduction of glass beads. You know, so prior to seed beads being produced in Europe, you know, Asia and Africa and places like that, and then being imported here, quill work and hair embroidery is really king when it comes to any sort of decorations on leggings, moccasins, bags, hair ornaments, pipes, everything. So I just wanted to show those and kind of give people an idea of what these things look like traditionally.